let's continue from where we left off last time. We got introduced to the Z transform, and the Z transform of a sequence X of n is defined as sum over all n X of n Z to the minus n. And the notation that is commonly used to denote a Z transform pair is similar to what was used for the Laplace transform and for the continuous time Fourier transform. So you denote this as X of n, you use this double arrow and then have X of Z on the right hand side. And the algebraic expression and the region of convergence is a shorthand notation for the power series. Z transform after all is a power series expansion. And the region in the Z plane over which this transform is valid is called as the region of convergence. So this parallels closely what was happening in the Laplace transform case. And then we saw the transform of A to the n u of n. So this transform, the algebraic expression is 1 by 1 over AZ inverse, but this is valid for mod Z strictly greater than mod A, and the related sequence that is left sided is minus A to the n u of minus n minus 1, and this has the identical algebraic expression. The only difference is of course the region of convergence. And then we also saw examples of finite duration sequences where the region of convergence is the entire Z plane except possibly for 0 and or infinity. Let us look at this X of Z 1 by 1 over AZ inverse. And this is nothing but Z by Z minus A. And the class of Z transforms that we will be looking at in this course will be of the form B of Z over A of Z. And this is ratio of polynomials. So this is very similar to the class of Laplace transforms that you had considered in signals and systems. There it was a ratio of polynomials in S. It was of the form B of S over A of S. So this is parallel to that. And this class of transforms, namely ratio of polynomials, be it either B of Z over A of Z for Z transform or B of S over A of S for the Laplace, this class is called, very good. So these are the class of rational functions. And they are the most well behaved class of functions you can think of, as well behaved as you guys are. These are not crazy functions. They won't cause trouble to us and to the mathematicians. And this is the only class of functions we will be considering in this course. This was the only class of functions that you were considering in signals and systems as far as Laplace transform went. And again, I had asked you the question why you were considering only systems, LTA systems whose input output relationship was governed by linear constant coefficient differential equations. Counterpart here would be linear constant coefficient difference equations. So again, if you had an input-output relationship that was governed by linear constant coefficient differential equation in continuous time, the corresponding transfer function had the form that was rational, BFS over AFS. We will also see that input-output relationships that are described by linear constant coefficient difference equation in the discrete time case will give rise to transfer functions in the Z domain, which are again rational. At that point, I had asked, why are you enamored so much by this class? Why is it that this class is so important? So coming back to X of Z, moment you realize that this is of the form B of Z over A of Z, we'll again invoke ideas that were used in continuous time. When you had a system transfer function, you talked about poles and zeros. So the same notion of poles and zeros applies here as well. Therefore, poles are zeros of A of Z. Zeros are, of course, zeros of B of Z. So in this particular example, 1 by 1 minus AZ inverse, 1, 0 is at Z equal to 0, and you have a pole at Z equal to A, and again, you may have learned as to why this is called a pole. If you have X of Z is a complex function of a complex variable, so it cannot be plotted because it requires two dimensions for the independent variable, real and imaginary parts, and then two dimensions for the dependent variable. So again, since we can't visualize things in 4D, you cannot plot X of Z versus Z. How are these functions then studied? Okay, but that will not be a complete study of the function. In terms of studying these, how are these studied? So these are studied using conformal mapping. You have the Z plane where you trace curves in the Z plane, and then you study the corresponding behavior in the X of Z plane, and that is studied using conformal mapping. But as was pointed out, one way of getting a feel for this is to plot magnitude of Z versus Z. So magnitude is a real quantity. Z, you take two dimensions, and then magnitude of X of Z is the third dimension. And whenever you hit a pole, the function will blow up. And the neighborhood of the function around a pole, if you plot X of Z versus Z, has the appearance of a physical pole. So here is two examples. So this is the real part, and this is the imaginary part. And this is the magnitude as Z varies. And in these cases where Z approaches these two points, the function becomes, magnitude becomes larger and larger. And at the pole location, the function will actually go to infinity. And this is the magnitude of gamma Z, where gamma of Z is the gamma function. And if n is an integer, gamma n is n minus 1 factorial. And whenever you evaluate the gamma function at minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and so on, it will blow up. So you see that at minus 1, this blows up. Again, at minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, and so on, it has poles. And this is real Z versus imaginary Z versus magnitude. Because it physically has the appearance of a pole, these are called poles. Now, let us gamma function is defined by an integral equation. I don't quite recall this, but this is from Wikipedia. that plot I have taken. So, look up gamma of z definition and I mean it is defined for all values of z, not just necessarily at the integer points. Okay. So, now let us consider a simple extension of this. Suppose I have x of n, which is half power n u of n plus minus 1/3 power n u of n. If this is my given sequence, I can think of this as x1 of n and this as x2 of n. And each of these sequences has the same form as what we had considered earlier, a to the n u of n. So, if I consider x1 of z, so this is 1 by 1 minus half z inverse, but this transform is valid only when mod z is greater than half. Similarly, x2 of z is 1 by 1 plus 1/3 z inverse, and this is valid when mod z is greater than 1/3, but really you are interested in the whole transform x of z. So, this is 1 by 1 minus half z inverse plus 1 by 1 plus 1/3 z inverse. If you want both of these expressions to be valid, then the region of convergence is the intersection of these two regions. Therefore, you need mod z greater than half, mod z greater than 1/3. So, this implies the final region of convergence is mod z greater than half. And if you simplify this, the algebraic expression for this turns out to be 1 by 1 minus half z inverse. And this, if you simplify, this turns out to be this. And this can always write it as 2 times 1 minus 1 over 12 z inverse. And then if you look at the poles, are at z equal to half and z equal to minus 1/3. What about the zeros? Clearly, there is a 0 at z equal to 1 over 12, all right. Anything else? Yes, very good. This is 0 at also z equal to 0. And the way to see this is the given x of z is nothing but z minus half z plus 1/3 2 times z by z minus 1 over 12. And in this form, you are able to see z equal to 0 is a 0. The same thing here. If you look at 1 by 1 minus a z inverse, if you put z equal to a, the denominator will go to 0. So, superficially, if you look at this, you would think there is a pole at z equal to a, and you might think there is no other root, there is no other 0, for example. Whereas, if you write it as z by z minus a, you are clearly able to see the 0 at z equal to 0. Therefore, the important point to note is when you are plotting poles and zeros, you are likely to miss the pole or a 0 at z equal to 0 if you look at the function in terms of z inverse. To make sure you do not miss any of these poles or zeros at z equal to 0, you have to write it in powers of z rather than powers of z inverse. And if you plot the pole 0 diagram, so this is real z, this is imaginary z. This is what is called the unit circle. So, this is a circle with radius 1, and this is an important boundary point in the z plane. An important boundary point in the S plane in the Laplace transform was the j omega axis. So, we will see that the unit circle plays the role of the j omega axis as far as the z transform is concerned. So, this is the unit circle, and here you have a pole at z equal to half, you have a pole at z equal to minus 1/3, you have a 0 at z equal to 1/12, you also have a 0 at z equal to 0. And for the first sequence, the transform was 1 by 1 minus half z inverse, and the region of convergence was mod z greater than half, and this is the circle mod z equal to half, and this is a rough sketch. So, let me mark this. So, for the first sequence, the region of convergence was outside the circle mod z equal to half. Mod z greater than half was the ROC for the first sequence x1 of z. So, you had this, and for the second sequence, the region of convergence was mod z greater than 1/3. Therefore, for the second sequence, this was the ROC, and hence the overall ROC is the intersection of the individual ROCs. So, this is as far as this example is concerned. Now, we will look at variance of this. Suppose you had x of n was minus half power n u of minus n minus 1 plus minus 1/3 to the n u of n. So, the algebraic expressions are not going to change. This of course is 1 by 1 minus half z inverse. this continues to be 1 plus 1/3 Z inverse. The main difference of course is now the region of convergence is mod Z less than half, whereas this region of convergence is mod Z greater than 1/3. Therefore, the overall region of convergence is the intersection of these two regions, and hence you have final ROC to be 1/3 strictly less than mod Z strictly less than 1/2. So, exactly the same pole zero plot holds. So, this of course is the unit circle, and then you have mod Z equal to half, mod Z equal to 1/3. So, the region of convergence is the intersection of mod Z greater than 1/3 and mod Z less than half. Therefore, for this particular case, this is the final ROC. It is the annular region between these two circles, and you can almost guess what the other variants are going to be. If you had now, you have minus n minus 1 minus minus 1/3 to the n u of n. Algebraic expressions are identical. This continues as in the previous case, its ROC being mod Z less than half, and in this case you have mod Z less than 1/3, right? Oh, so this should be u of minus n minus 1, yes, thanks. Therefore, the final ROC is mod Z less than 1/3, and hence this is the unit circle. These are mod Z equal to half, mod Z equal to 1/3, and the final ROC is this. If you notice in the very first example where you had the sequence half to the n u of n and minus 1/3 to the n u of n, both of them are right sided. And later we will see that if we had a right sided sequence, the region of convergence will always be outside of a certain circle. What that circle is will depend upon the sequence, but in general, if you had a right sided sequence, the ROC will always be outside of a certain circle. In the first example, both sequences were right sided. Therefore, ROCs, both ROCs were outside of their respective circles, and the region of convergence was dictated by the pole that had the largest radius. In the second example, one sequence was left sided, the other sequence was right sided. This ROC is inside of a certain circle, this ROC is outside of a certain circle, and the final ROC is the intersection of these two. The third example is both sequences being left sided. Therefore, the ROC is going to be inside of a certain circle in both cases, and the final ROC is the intersection of these two regions, and it is now dictated by the smallest pole. And the last variant is x of n is going to be half to the n u of n minus minus 1/3 to the n u of minus n minus 1. So, this region of convergence is mod Z greater than half, this region of convergence is mod Z less than 1/3, and the intersection is null. There is no common region of convergence. And hence, the Z transform of this given sequence X of n does not exist, right. So, this is an important point, that is X of Z does not exist. So, this is completely analogous to what you had learnt in Laplace. In the Laplace transform case, you had real S. So, this was really the sigma axis, this was g omega, and then if we had two poles like this, what was happening there was you had vertical lines like this, and then if the region of convergence was this, this gave rise to x1 of t that was right sided. If the region of convergence was between these two vertical lines, you had x2 of t that was two sided. On the other hand, if we had the ROC to be given like this, you had an x3 of t that was left sided. So, when we look at the convergence criterion for Z transform, we will see that the regions of convergence will be for rational transfer functions be bounded by circles, whereas in the Laplace transform case, the region of convergence is bounded by vertical lines. One difference between Laplace and Z is that if you had, if x of t is between t1 and t2, so this is a finite duration function, and then the function is absolutely integrable, then ROC is, what is the ROC in the Laplace transform case? So, it is the entire S plane. Now, since we have already seen what the ROC is for the finite duration sequence in the Z transform case, what is one difference that is that should strike you when you look at this ROC versus ROC in the Z transform case for finite duration sequences? Very good. So, if x of n is between these two intervals, ROC is the entire Z plane, except that 0 may not belong, okay. So, therefore, if you have finite duration function, S equal to 0 is always part of the region of convergence, whereas Z equal to 0 need not be part of the ROC for a finite duration sequence.